Welcome back to Volunteer State Community College in Gallatin, Tennessee for game two of today's doubleheader between Southwest Tennessee Salukis and the Pioneers of Volunteer State. Salukis took game one of the doubleheader 7-2 in extra innings with a five-run top of the ninth inning to even the series. Pioneers won yesterday's game one 12-2 in a mercy rule fashion in seven innings. So the nine-inning game went seven innings, and the seven-inning game went nine innings. So we are right where we're scheduled for to begin with, 16 innings in. And here game two is scheduled for seven innings. Our umpires have arrived for game two. Coach Shane Kemp putting away the hose. He has watered down the infield. Let's get to the Toyota of Gallatin starting lineups. First for the visiting Salukis, Stephen Hayden in center field leading off. Sammy Chapman getting his first start of the series, playing left field, batting second. Logan Luckett batting third, playing shortstop. Charlie Smith in the cleanup spot. He's going to be behind the plate. Hayden Collins, fresh from the six innings as a start, his first start of the year, is the DH, batting fifth. Evan Ash come out and play first base, batting sixth. Connor Brinkley playing third base, batting seventh. Preston Rager with his first collegiate hit, as I understand it, based on the stats that I've seen. Freshman right fielder, he'll bat eighth. And Ryan Welch back at second base, batting ninth. And on the mound, sophomore left-hander Peyton Charles. He's 6'2", 175 pounds from Henry County, Tennessee. Buchanan or Buckcannon, not sure how they pronounce that. He is the third starter for head coach Aaron Schoenrock. As you see, the Pioneers taking the field. We'll have a different lineup out here. We'll do the defensive lineup to start. Gage Hoover out in left field, getting his first start of the weekend. Stephen Bell will patrol out in center field, moving over from his normal right field spot. Cam Hodges, the Smoky Bear from Sevier County High, from his injury, is at third base. Logan Molnar at shortstop. Brady Knepper, who finished game one of the doubleheader, at second base. He's back out at second base. Connor Paul at first, and Christian Dunn behind the plate catching Chip Harris, who's on for his sixth start of the year, seventh appearance. He has a 2-2 record, and 18 in the third innings. Giving up 26 hits, 22 runs, 19 earned. Has walked 12, struck out 17. Has a 9.33 ERA. And he will be tasked with helping the Pioneers to get their first series win of the year. Been a struggle in conference play. I say that is not true. Pioneers won two out of three from Dyersburg State. I forgot that. So trying to get their second series win of the year. Been swept by Walter State, Chattanooga State, Columbia State. That may not be true. Roan State. As Stephen Hayden steps into the batter's box. First pitch from Harris is high, and we are underway. The game time temperature brought to you by Accurate Mortgage. 76 degrees as we get started at 3:20 p.m. Central. Two balls and no strikes. First pitch brought to you by Sumner Regional Medical Center. Fouled off. Goes 2-1. Stephen Hayden was 1-for-4 in game one of the doubleheader. Scored a run. A couple stolen bases. And Harris in danger of walking the first batter he faces here in the top of the first inning. Harris, a freshman out of Clarksville, Tennessee. He does walk the leadoff batter.
Now batting number 18, Sammy Chapman.
Walks got Caleb Pika in trouble, and the seventh definitely. certainly not what pitching coach Sam Folks and head coach Jim McGuire want to see from the freshman right-hander is giving free bases out. Sammy Chapman had a big hit in game one of the doubleheader. Swings at the first pitch, fouls it off. Chapman came in as a pinch hitter in that top of the seventh, and he drove in the tying runs in the top of the seventh. He went one for two. Also had a big ground out that moved a runner over to third. There's a throw over to first. Close play. But the ball snuck out of Connor Paul's glove. Hard to call a runner out as you see that baseball trickling away from the fielder. Another throw over to first. Harris, 6'2", 205-pound freshman from Clarksville High School up in Clarksville, Tennessee. That's the home of Fort Campbell Army Base, about 45 minutes away from Nashville. There's a tag applied to Hayden, who apparently got his hand down on the base before his belly hit the ground. Close play, said Hayden, with a couple stolen bases in game one. Bluffed going there, but stays at first. Hayden now with 16 stolen bases in 17 attempts. Keep it on the wide camera for this back and forth between Chip Harris, Stephen Hayden. Pitch, runner goes, pitches a ball, throw is slightly to the left of second base. Christian Dunn, guessing, is bothered by that left-handed batter who is right on the chalk with that back foot. Stolen base to Hayden, his third of the day. Swing and a miss on a changeup. Hayden now with four stolen bases for this series. That's going to be a hit batter as Chapman hobbled there. That pitch came in. They're going to send Chapman to first, and they're going to send Hayden back to second base. So a walk and a hit batter, and Southwest Tennessee is starting off well here in the second game of the doubleheader. Two free bases provided by Chip Harris. His second hit batter of the year. Now Logan Luckett, who went 3-for-5 in game one of the doubleheader, steps to the plate.
Now batting number two, Logan Luckett.
Fastball buried down around the feet of Luckett. Freshman who's started and played in every game for Southwest Tennessee, 46th game of the year. He hits one into left field. That's going to drop. And Hoover's going to try to make that sliding catch. I thought that was going to drop well before where Gage Hoover was playing out there, but it ends up falling safely, and the bases are now loaded with Salukis. Luckett picks up his fourth hit. Oh, okay. I am totally missing something. What did I miss there, Corbin?
Number 34, Charlie Smith.
They called Sammy Chapman out? Oh, okay. Well, I have to correct that, but there's going to be a base hit into right field. They're going to be the first run. So an out was picked up. They said that Chapman swung. I did not see any of that happening. Thank you for the assist, Corbin Overbay. My spinning plates.
Up to bat, number 8, Hayden
apparently
Collins.
Crashed to the ground. I'm describing action. It's not happened. So Chapman not hit by a pitch. Yeah. I'm not a liar on purpose. So back-to-back hits for Southwest Tennessee, and they lead 1-0. Hayden Collins, the DH, steps in. Gaze out these MGM windows. There are, in fact, 2 runners on, 1st and 2nd. Breaking pitch. Apparently a check swing by Collins. Count goes 2 balls and no strikes on Hayden Collins. He's played in both games. Starting second baseman in game 1 and then moved over to first base. He went 0 for 2, a couple strikeouts and a walk. And was on the mound for game 1 of the doubleheader, looks at a called strike. Pop up to the left side. It should be playable. Gage Hoover over. Logan Molnar, he's looking up into the sky, but going to give way to Hoover. Left fielder for out number 2. So a reset here of the inning is
now batting number 19,
I have to figure it out.
Evan Ash.
Stephen Hayden walked and then stole 2nd. Sammy Chapman apparently had a check swing with 2 strikes as he was hit by the pitch. It was determined that he swung. I thought there were bases loaded. As Logan Luckett singled. There's a called strike to Evan Ash. Lined out to center field. Stephen Bell has it measured. And we'll make the catch for out number 3. So Southwest Tennessee scores 1. Run on 2 hits, no errors. 2 runners left on base, so the leadoff walk comes home to roost for the Salukis. So the walk to Hayden, strikeout of Chapman, then a single in the left field, an RBI for Logan Luckett drives in Hayden. Then the single to right field by Charlie Smith. Put runners at 1st and 2nd, fly out to left and to center, ends the inning. The Pioneers will come to the plate. We'll give you the Toyota of Gallatin batting order for VolState. Logan Molnar will lead off. Brady Knepper is playing 2nd base. He's going to bat 2nd. Stephen Bell hitting 3rd. Cannon Lewis in the cleanup spot. Cam Hodges in right field batting 5th. Connor Paul at 1st base batting 6th. Christian Dunn is the 7-hole hitter. Gage Hoover is batting 8th, and Nathan Aguilar batting 9th. Peyton Charles out on the mound for his 11th start of the year. Sophomore, second-year player with Southwest Tennessee. And he will try to match Wes Butler in the win column. Charles comes in with a 4-4 record. 44 innings of work, giving up 50 hits, 37 runs, 28 are earned. Walked 22, struck out 43. Has plunked 10 batters with a 5.73 ERA. Southwest Tennessee is not sure if they've won a series this year. I know they've won a game in most of the series. I don't think they have. Not sure if they've been swept or not. I have to get my research staff on that. Hey, wait a minute. I don't have one. Unless I've got somebody out there. Unless it's. What was that? Got an email from somebody earlier telling me where Elkton, Kentucky was. Very much appreciate that. Greenhead at Yahoo. Logan Molnar to lead off. Bottom of the first for VolState. He had a hit in five plate appearances and a leadoff single to start the game in game one of the doubleheader. And went 0 for 4 after that, swing and a miss there. He's down in the count 0-2. Beautiful sunny day here in Middle Tennessee. One-two pitch is going to hit Molnar in the wallet. He didn't swing, did he? I better keep my eyes on him.
Now batting number three, Brady.
You guys will help me out, won't you? That is an actual hit by pitch. The 11th of the year. He is averaging one per outing. Well, Southwest Tennessee won the first series they played of the year. Two out of three games against Cleveland State. As Brady Knepper steps to the plate, he's going to look at a called strike, like a changeup, or at least I hope that was a changeup. Otherwise, Peyton Charles is throwing batting practice. His stats does not appear as though he's throwing batting practice. This is wide of the mark there. It's their only series win was the very first one against Cleveland State. Fouled off to the right side. Charles ahead. Had a win against Jackson State, a win against Motlow State, a win against Dyersburg State, Walter State, and Columbia State. And now one against Volunteer State. So have not been swept. There's a throw to first. Evan Ash has to dig it out of the damp dirt. It's not so damp that we call it mud, but delivery is Charles is just as he's going coming to the plate. He pulls the ball out of his glove and then back into his glove, looks like. Knepper, a freshman from Greenbrier High School, Greenbrier, Tennessee, transferred from Cumberland University, where he was this past fall. 2-2 pitch fouled off, Sumner Regional Medical Center foul ball. We're waiting on the screen. I thought we were going to get out in left center, just to the left of the batter's eye and the right of the batter's eye, that would say Volunteer State Baseball. That would have the Sumner Regional Medical Center logo on it. It's way by Full Count Ministries, Full Count. Stay tuned. We'll have another Full Count Ministries verse of the game at the conclusion of this ball game. Full count pitch, full count, first pitch, foul ball. What do you think the percentages of that are, Corbin? If the batter swings on the first pitch after the count becomes full, how often does he foul it off? Hop up to the right side. This is going to be foul as well. Evan Ash is over. He's going to make a no-look catch over his head. I'm telling you, he's caught 16 innings, and now he's out there ranging in foul territory to make a catch. Nice play by Evan Ash. The Canadian, eh? Ontario. One of two Canadians I've seen on the roster. Jeff Two, relief pitcher. Sometimes a relief pitcher. Has seven starts. T-I-W. Pronounced two. Fastball catches that outside corner. Charlie Smith, who played first base in game one of the doubleheader, is behind the plate. Stephen Bell facing the lefty for the first time. He pops one off to the left side. Brinkley over, and he will not have a play as that will just get out of the fenced-in area here at the Tim Garrett Baseball Complex. Count goes no balls and two strikes. Bell was 2-for-4 in game one of the doubleheader, had a double and an RBI. Scored a run. And just as I go to the tight shot, Charles throws over to first base to push Molnar back. The tying run, Molnar, who was plunked in the back pocket, leads off. Slow breaking pitch gets Stephen Bell swinging.
Stepping to the plate, number 30, Cannon Lewis.
First strikeout of the game for Peyton Charles. Cannon Lewis, 1-for-4 in game one of the doubleheader. Runner goes. Pitch is a strike. Throw down to second base. Molnar does not slide. I don't understand. I'm not. It's unfathomable to me as to why you don't slide on a stolen base attempt. The fielder is maybe late arriving to the base, but unless it's a matter of there's too much pain involved with maybe a little harder surface, maybe that's it, but. Lewis now has a runner in scoring position. Down in the count, 0-2 with two outs. Logan Molnar still has not been caught stealing. That was a close play. Good throw by Charlie Smith, but Molnar did have an excellent jump. Just missed outside as Creel Waddell is our home plate umpire. He had the plate for yesterday's contest. Some communication going from his end to Charlie Smith, the catcher. May not have been all that lovely. Foul ball down the right field line. That'll get out of play. And off the pole, back into the playing surface. Arena baseball would have still had that as a foul ball, though. It did not get across the fair line, sometimes known as the foul line. Problem is, if it hits that line down there, the ball's fair, so I don't know how you call it a foul line. One ball, two strikes. Molnar started to go again, had a pretty good jump. That pitch fouled off to the right side. On deck, Cam Hodges. Charles has his sign. He's ready. Lewis does not offer at the high fastball. Two balls, two strikes, two outs, and a runner at second base. Swing and a miss. Charles picks up another strikeout. It's two in a row. No runs, no hits, no errors. One runner left on base after one. Southwest Tennessee with the lead. 1-0. You're listening to the VolState Sports Network.
Have you ever wondered what happens when you click buy it now? A whole series of transactions take place from the manufacturer to your front door.
That is logistics and supply chain management. At VolState, we offer end-to-end supply chain courses.
Going into the future, our students need to understand these processes.
A lot of business is dependent upon getting a product on time.
Students here at VolState are able to leave here with that knowledge.
Because the supply chain
is counting on me.
We're all working in the cloud. But what really is the cloud? If you start pulling back the clouds themselves, you find out it's an infrastructure. Computer science is really computer engineering. Right now,
Middle Tennessee is quickly becoming a growing tech hub with several IT companies that are looking for skilled workers.
If you're pursuing the CIT program at Ball State, you're preparing yourself to fill those positions.
Move to the top of the second inning. Salukis will send 7, 8, and 9 to the plate to face Chip Harris. Starting right-hander from Clarksville, Tennessee. Connor Brinkley, Preston Rager, and Ryan Welch due up for the Salukis. Switch hitting Connor Brinkley. Dig in from the left side. Harris ready to go. Sails a changeup outside. Just had a thought about why, as Brinkley drives one foul down the right field line, why Logan Molnar may not have been sliding there. He injured himself last year as a head first slide into third base against Lake Area Academy, who the Pioneers will take on next week, weather permitting, here at Pioneer Field. And maybe he does not want to head first slide as Chip Harris picks up the strikeout, as I missed a strike on that foul ball. Good start to the inning for Harris, his second strikeout of the game. Maybe he's just tentative about sliding feet first. Not sure, but they surely didn't think that, wasn't thinking a play was going to be made on him, but I'm sure he knows how to slide. That's not the issue, but I can understand if you're a little tentative because of an injury. He has played the entire year for Vol State as Preston Rager swings and misses. Rager picked up a hit in the five-run ninth, and he's going to look at a two-ball and two-strike pitch. It's like Chip Harris is just rearing back and playing hardball now. See if he comes with a breaker here. He does. Swing and a miss. Down goes Rager. First two have been retired via the strikeout here in the second. Chip Harris hopefully has reached his stride after giving up one run on two hits in the first. Now Ryan Welch, second baseman, it's at ball one. Welch was 0 for 2 in game one of the doubleheader. Ahead in the count now. Three balls, no strikes. Welch 5'9", 175 pounds. 3-0 pitch. For some reason, he was looking like he was going to swing it and almost completely did, but pitch is called a strike. It's an unusual take. Does not take there. Lines one out to right field. We can't Hodges. Perfectly placed. Former high school teammate of Corbin Overbay is, makes the third out of the inning in 1-2-3 fashion for Chip Harris. Couple strikeouts and a line out. And it's Ball State's turn to bat again. Find themselves down 1-0. Let's tell you about our other sponsors, Wilson Bank and Trust. They got a sign out there on that left center field wall. Tommy Decker is an assistant vice president loan officer at the Hendersonville branch. He's another former player at MTSU for Coach McGuire. Wilson Bank and Trust is an independent community-based bank headquartered in Lebanon, but they've got locations throughout Middle Tennessee, including in Hendersonville. You can call Tommy Decker, 615-444-2265. And the Curbing Edge, they've sponsored VolState baseball. Another former player, Troy Harp, he and his wife Stacy own the Curbing Edge. It's a decorative concrete curbing company in Rutherford County. You can find them on the web at NashvilleCurbing.com or call 615-838-4004. Time for the Pioneers to string some hits together here against Peyton Charles, coming out for his second inning of work. Cam Hodges had a tremendous couple-week stretch here. Very limited action early on, and he's actually had some sporadic play. He likes to swing at that first pitch, though. It's not like he's worried about getting up there and making an out on the first pitch. He's thinking positively and saying, I'm going to get a hit on the first pitch. Comes in hitting .471. He is 8 for 17, has a double. Chases there. He has 4 RBIs, also walked 3 times. Been on base 55% of the time, but he's going to go down on strikes and 3 pitches here on a changeup by Charles. That's 3 strikeouts in a row. Strikes out about a batter an inning. Connor Paul steps to the plate. He was 3 for 4 and was our Toyota of Gallatin player of the game in game one. The doubleheader, a couple singles and a double. Just a hitter. Came into the day hitting .329. That average is going up. Now 27 hits. One behind Logan Molnar for the team lead. Looks at a called strike. Connor Paul has only struck out 7 times this year. He puts the bat on the ball. Just like that, hits one up the middle. It's going to be a tough play. Ryan Welch is not going to get the speedy Connor Paul. That throw is over the glove of Evan Ash, but backing up is Charlie Smith. An infield single for the Bear, also known as CP. Connor Paul is now 4 for 5. On the day, Connor was 1 for 4 in yesterday's 12-2 win. Christian Dunn steps to the plate. He swings at the first pitch he sees. Done a transfer from Dyersburg State by way of Blinn Junior College in Texas. Sophomore from Collierville, Tennessee. It's one high and deep to left field. Back goes Sammy Chapman. He is at the wall, and it is off the top of the fence. It will drop in there for a double for Christian Dunn, and Connor Paul motors on over to third base. Christian Dunn missed a 2-run home run by 6 inches. I think that might have hit off the top, the yellow.
Now batting number 16.
Sammy Chapman actually had a chance at it, but could not haul it in. Christian Dunn picks up a 1-out double. That is Dunn's 4th double of the year. He has 5 extra base hits in his 9 hits on the season. Gage Hoover steps in. Going to give the Pioneers the lead here in the bottom of the second. Gage, the son of Mike and Angie Hoover, pops one up to the right side. It's like that'll get out of play. Ash over and watches it one hop over the maintenance shed. So back-to-back hits brought to you by Hit After Hit. Go to hitafterhitonline.com. Lem Pilkington, a supporter of VolState baseball. Hoover pops this one up. This might be playable. Again, over to the right side. Ash is over, and he's going to watch that one hit just in the grass on the other side of the fence. Hoover practicing the pop-ups to the fans on the right side of the field. Pop-ups in the infield, not going to drive in a run here, though, Gage. You're going to have to, as they say in Little League, straighten it out. He straightened it out, but again, to the right side, put a dent in the maintenance shed. He's handing out souvenirs like he's got money to spare. I did see him checking his phone between games and asked him if he was checking his portfolio. That might get a run in. That's out to right center field. Steven Hayden over in the gap. He dropped the ball, but they are going to call him out. So a sack fly for Hoover. He dropped it as he was trying to pull it out of there. There is the Framework Athletics first run of the game. Driven in by Gage Hoover on the sacrifice fly.
Now batting out number two, Nathan Aguilar.
Hunter Paul, who reached on the infield single, comes in to score, and now the go-ahead run is 90 feet away. Christian Dunn as Nathan Aguilar steps to the plate. Aggie regularly swings at that first pitch. Looks at a called strike on the inside corner. His first at-bat since he pretty much separated his shoulder on a tag play at the plate. He plays third base, and he was running the base runner to home plate, and he dove for the tag. The home plate umpire said that he tugged him. We saw from up here that was not the case, but he separated his shoulder there for Justin McKinney, the all-world trainer here at VolState. Was able to get it back into place, and Aggie said that the seventh time that he's done that in his life. On deck is Logan Molnar. Aguilar hits a ground ball to second. Two hops to Luckett. Strong throw over to Ash at first base, and that ends the second. Ball State gets the equalizer. One run on two hits. RBI on the sack fly by Gage Hoover. Drives in the Framework Athletics first run of the game. There were no errors and one runner left on base. Each team scores in a half inning. We are through two. Scheduled for seven here at Vol State. Be right back on the Vol State Sports Network.
Cybercrimes take place online, and companies need more well-trained workers to stop it.
VolState is training me to help combat cybercrimes in the future.
We're training them for those type of jobs that are out there. VolState CIT programs prepare students to earn industry standard certifications within the IT industry.
I choose VolState because the future needs me now. My story could be your story.
A degree in criminal justice can help you find the exciting career that you've been looking for. As a member of law enforcement, as a crime scene investigator, a teacher in a classroom, a detective working on cases, a lawyer or judge, or nearly any job where you get to put the bad guys away. Learn more at volstate.edu.
Move to the top of the third inning. VolState tied it in the bottom of the second. Top of the lineup for the Southwest Tennessee Salukis. They play their home games in Millington, Tennessee, the USA Stadium. Stephen Hayden, who walked and scored in the first inning, steps in, looks at a ball. Chip Harris out on the mound for his third inning of work. Popped up into center field, Stephen Bell over. Hodges is going to give way, and he looked like he was out there ready to catch it on the bounce if it came off of Stephen Bell, who told me about where the ball that he lost in the sun that last weekend, I guess, lost one in the sun, and it hit him in the leg, he said. He said he's got a big old bruise on his leg. Sammy Chapman had that unusual strikeout in the first inning, swings and misses. He was hit by a pitch, but he was judged to have taken a swing on the pitch. I haven't had a chance to go back and look at it. I'll have to do that after this game. But my opinion doesn't matter. Chapman, who did not start in either of the first two games, was a huge factor in game two, the doubleheader, though, as he came in to pinch hit and drove in the tying runs in the top of the seventh inning. Fouls another pitch back. Then Southwest Tennessee scored five in the top of the seventh, or top of the ninth, to take a 7-2 lead, and that was the final tally for Southwest Tennessee. We have a full count, Ministries full count, with a one out and nobody on. Changed up, shallow center field. Out goes Logan Molnar. He'll make the catch for out number two. So there, Corbin, was a time that he swung on the first pitch after it became full, and he did not foul it off. So that would be in the not fouling it off category. It's about 50% of the time in college baseball. Breaking pitch at the letters for a called strike to Logan Luckett. You want to start keeping track of that? My college coach gave me that little nugget way back in the early 80s. That would be 1980s. That's a long time ago, isn't it? No, it wasn't the 1880s. It's a ground ball to third. That's going to catch Aguilar, knock his lid off, carry him over to Logan Molnar. His lid falls off. And Southwest Tennessee is going to have a runner at first base on the error, bringing Charlie Smith to the plate.
Now batting number 34, Charlie Smith.
Pioneers had trouble keeping Logan Luckett off the base paths today. Changeup. This is low and inside. That was a shot right to Aguilar. Took a hop he wasn't expecting, but throw over to first. Luckett back. Another throw over and another close play. Luckett had a stolen base in yesterday's game. None in action today. And goes to two balls and no strikes to the cleanup hitter, Charlie Smith, who had a single to right field in the first. That's when I was realizing that they did not have the bases loaded. Pops that one up and out of play. Sumner Regional Medical Center foul ball. Noah Ward is our ball boy here for game two. Two outs. Pitch in the dirt, read by Luckett, and Dunn will eat that one. Luckett moves down to second on the wild pitch. Now in scoring position. All four. Second walk of the game for Chip Harris.
Number eight, Hayden Collins.
So an error and now a walk brings up Hayden Collins, the DH. First pitch misses down low. Collins comes in hitting 310. Pretty easy to figure that batting average. 31 hits and 100 at-bats. Our math geniuses up here, Corbin Overbay and Braxton Alexander in the press box. They were all over that one. Yep. You're like pre-med or something, aren't you, Corbin? You'd like it. You can put a Band-Aid on. Ground ball foul over the outstretched hands of third base coach and head coach Eric Schoenrock. Business major, he says. Just, is it business, B-I-D-N-E-S-S, business, or is it actually business with an S? It's for real business, isn't it? Runner goes. Pitch is not handled at the plate. Stolen base. Stolen base at least for Logan Luckett. Charlie Smith followed along. I'm sure that in the dugout, the official score is going to give a stolen base there as well. Now runners at second and third with two outs. Fly ball over to left field down toward the bullpen, and it's caught by Gage Hoover. He got over there in fine fashion and made the catch. Didn't think he was going to have room, but ended up coming up with the inning-ending putout. Hayden Collins has flown out to Gage Hoover twice. Now, no runs, no hits, one error. There was also a walk in there, and Chip Harris stranded two more runners. We're still tied 1-1. I'd like to thank Game Time Sports Fields and Line to Line, owned by Bill Marbot, run also by Steven Dodson. Been big players here for the amenities for the Pioneer Field. Netting and padding, dirt work here at Pioneer Field at the Tim Garrett Baseball Complex. Game Time Sports Field's been the grounds crew for TCAA Conference Tournament. Just was watching a breaking pitch thrown there by Peyton Charles to that Copeland Bradford catcher. All he's got is a mask on. Threw a curveball, but I think he was expecting a fastball or something straight. And good thing it wasn't hard. He would have been hurt. Game Time Sports Field, I think, also does the grounds crew for the SEC tournament. I think I've seen them down there at Hoover before, back years ago when I used to take my son down during his high school years, right as school used to finish, right on that Tuesday, I think. And then the SEC tournament started on Wednesday. They'd play four games on Wednesday, four games on Thursday, and then back it down to two on Friday. And we would catch all eight on the Wednesday, Thursday. And if we felt like it, we'd go out there for Friday. Sometimes we'd just drive on back home. Top of the lineup to face Peyton Charles. First pitch swinging, Logan Molnar. Almost like clockwork. You throw a strike or something close to the plate, Logan's going to take a hack at it on the first pitch. He was hit by a pitch to lead off the game for Vol State. And that one gets off the glove of Charlie Smith. Takes a bite out of our home plate umpire, Creel Waddell. That's not going to endear yourself to the home plate umpire. Nubber, that'll get down to first base. Evan Ash will glove and step on the base.
Now batting,
an easier
three,
play
Brady
you
Nepper.
Won't find. Brady Nepper popped out to Ash. Nice play in foul territory. got my level, man. Papa, like Paul's dad, Gary Nepper, sitting in the lawn chair inside the fenced-in area. That's popped up to the left side. Logan Luckett out on the outfield grass. He's under it. He's going to make the catch. So a couple quick outs here in the bottom of the third.
Stepping to the plate, number 22, pop outs for Nepper.
Stephen Bell, strikeout victim in the first, steps to the plate. You know, you swing at that first pitch and you don't give me much time to talk about you and your family and your mama and them, grandparents, what you ate for lunch, all important things that people want to know. Swing and a miss. Little known fact, Stephen Bell is a twin, just as I am. He has a twin brother named Mark who attends Tennessee Tech. Flies that one off to the left side. Logan Luckett looks like he will give way to Sammy Chapman. We'll have to tell you more about Stephen Bell the next time he comes to the plate. We can tell you that parents are Frank and Katie. 3 up, 3 down for the Pioneers in the third. We will move further ahead in the action, moving to the top of the fourth as this one is moving right along. Scheduled for 7 innings here at VolState. It's 1-1.
Have you ever wondered what happens when you click buy it now? A whole series of transactions take place from the manufacturer to your front door.
That is logistics and supply chain management.
At VolState, we offer end-to-end supply chain courses.
Going into the future, our students need to understand these processes.
A lot of business is dependent upon getting a product on time.
Students here at VolState are able to leave here with that knowledge.
Because the supply chain
is counting on me.
Top of the fourth inning. Carter, call me Chip Harris. Back out on the mound for the Pioneers. Have to do a double take when I look at the stats. It says Carter Harris, and I said, no, I'm looking for Chip Harris. He went 6 innings against Cumberland JV. That was one of the 2 games that I did not attend. It was during my COVID week, and that ball's drilled out to deep left center field. Back goes Hoover, and he's going to make a running catch just at the warning track to retire Evan Ash. Ash has flown out twice.
Now batting number 15, Connor Brinkley.
A-S-H-E, Evan Ash. He's now 0 for 2. Connor Brinkley steps in. He was a strikeout victim leading off the second. Chip Harris, 4 hits, 1 run, which was unearned against Cumberland, and a 9-1 win. Changeup misses high. Brinkley from Marion, Arkansas. It's a line drive base hit up the middle. Third hit of the ball game for the Salukis. I believe that might be the first hit of the series for Connor Brinkley. 0-for-4 in game 2 of the doubleheader. No, he had a hit yesterday's game. It was 1-for-3.
Number 14, Preston Rager.
Preston Rager steps to the plate. Also struck out in the second. Looks at a called strike at the knees on the outside corner. Marion, Arkansas, I believe, is just on the other side of Memphis. Runner goes, pitches in the dirt. Christian Dunn does not let it go. Now a runner in scoring position for Rager, the freshman right fielder. Nice pitch by Harris there. like Brinkley or head coach Schoenrock picked the right pitch to go on. Pitch he went on was an off-speed pitch. Another off-speed pitch there. Count moves to Full Count Ministries, Full Count. Ground ball, that's fair down the third base line. That's going to be trouble. That's going to score a run. Reger picks up his second hit of the day and of the season. Drives in the go-ahead run. Give the Salukis a 2-1 lead. His first extra base hit.
Ryan Welch.
A single and an RBI in that five-run ninth. Ryan Welch steps to the plate. He lined out to Cam Hodges to end the second inning. Steps up with a runner at second and one out. He's going to square around the bunt and miss the bunt. West Tennessee had back-to-back hits in the first inning and now back-to-back hits here in the fourth. Change him up way out in front. On deck leadoff batter Stephen Hayden. Marion, Arkansas. Close by Memphis. Just north of West Memphis in Arkansas. One, two count. We'll have to wait. Chip Harris with his disengagement for this batter. Did not throw to the base. Seen a couple of Southwest Tennessee pitchers just go ahead and throw to a fielder regardless of where he was. Breaking pitch catches that outside corner as it whispers on its way by for strike three.
Up to bat, number six, Stephen Hayden.
Fourth strikeout of the game by Harris. Now two outs. Hayden 0-for-1 with a walk and a run scored, steps to the plate. Fastball just missed outside. Trying to nibble on that outside corner and missed with two fastballs. Lady Pioneers lost to the Lady Senators of Walter State in game one of the doubleheader today, 13-3. I assume that was a run rule game. Not sure how many innings they played. They had to play five at least. Swing and a miss on a high fastball. Lady Senators, I think they're ranked in the top 10. I know that. Morristown, Tennessee. They are ranked seventh in the country as they come in to VolState. They've so far taken two out of three. There is ball four. Third walk of the game for Harris.
Stepping to the plate, number 18, Sammy Chapman.
Sammy Chapman will get an at-bat with two on and two out here in the top of the fourth. Well, Southwest Tennessee has taken the lead here in the top half of the inning. Lead 2-1. Chapman has struck out and popped out. Has no problem going the opposite way. He can also pull one, too. He's tied for the home run lead with Logan Luckett with six. He's from South Haven, Mississippi, with the North Point Christian High School. He drills one to deep right field. This may be out of here. Cam Hodges is back, and that's off the top of the batting cage out in right field for a three-run home run. He has just taken over the home run lead for Southwest Tennessee. He reached out and pulled that one. Gives Southwest the 5-1 lead. He has five RBIs on the day, two in game one of the doubleheader, and now his seventh big fly. Now has 27 RBIs for the year. Logan Luckett steps to the plate. As a breaking pitch, Luckett, I think, is not happy that he didn't offer it that. I think his disgust there was for the home plate umpire. Tried to get him to swing at the high fastball. Luckett having none of that. So four runs in the inning for Southwest. He's swinging him as Harris gets Luckett on strikes. I think that's the first time that Luckett has gone down on strikes. But before that, single by Connor Brinkley, a double by Preston Rager, a walk. And then a three-run home run by Sammy Chapman. Did not get the start in first two games because they were started by left-handed pitchers. But he took Chip Harris deep. So four runs on three hits, no errors. Nobody left on. Southwest Tennessee now leads 5-1. That's going to take stringing together some hits for the Pioneers if they're going to be able to take the series from Southwest Tennessee. I want to thank Framework Athletics, located at 104B Jessica Lauren Court in Hendersonville, for having the Pioneers train over in their facility. Owned by former 15-year major leaguer Zach Duke and Ryan McDuffie from Hendersonville High School, co-owner with his wife of CrossFit Hendersonville and one of the seven founding members of the Full Count Ministry is Ryan McDuffie. We have the Framework Athletics first run of the game. I guess we need a sponsor for runs 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6 now in this game. We need Paul White to come up with something. What do you think? Parker, you think Paul White come up with something? He'll be the runs 2 through 10. Gonna have to see if we can work a deal. Our negotiator is Braxton Alexander. He's trying to get like free shoes for everybody over here. You're talking about free stuff. Cannon Lewis steps to the plate, the DH, to face Peyton Charles. Fly ball out to right field. Rager over into foul territory. He's got room and he overruns it. It falls safely to the landscape. Sometimes, Braxton, I just tune you out, okay? See, I do, I've got the microphone here, and you don't. So you want to work for it. Okay, so now it becomes an income. Oh, you got to hit the sign. Okay. That's true. Then it becomes income, though. You hit the sign, you win a free curbed edge out there. One, two on the scoreboard. Is that right? I got 1-1. Well, it's 1-2 now, at least. Lewis reaches out to foul that one off. I'm guessing that's a two-strike swing right there, so I was probably wrong. Corbin Overbay gives me the international sign of affirmative, the head shake. Whether that's in, you could be in Europe or Asia or Africa or here in the United States. The international sign for yes. Give me another international sign for yes. Parker White, I'm telling you, he is all over it. Thumbs up. 1-2 pitch to Cannon Lewis. That's right off the glove of Peyton Charles and into center field for a base knock for Cannon.
Now batting number 35,
Lewis
Cam
now
Hodges.
1-2. Now get ready, folks. As soon as he steps in the batter's box, he's ready to hit. Cameroon Hodges. Out on three pitches in the second. Peyton Charles pitching at the stretch. Hodges looks at a called strike, but not a real hittable pitch there. That was one of those on the inside portion of the river, as the umpires call it. Swing and a miss. I've just seen five pitches, and they've all either been in the zone or he swung at it. It might have been a little bit high, but Cam ready to hit now. Throw over to first base. Cannon Lewis, who was about 2.5 steps off of first, took a step and a flop to back to the bag. He's in there safely. My ball out to right field. Look at Stephen Hayden coming over. I thought he was going to take that ball away from Rager. Rager, the right fielder, makes the catch.
Number 32, Connor Paul.
Now one out, Connor Paul, who had an infield single right up the middle. Scored the only run of the game for Pioneers. He is 4-for-5 today in the doubleheader. Swings and fouls that one into the Saluki dugout, sometimes known as the Siliques. Isn't that right, Braxton? You didn't say it. You're right. You didn't. But I have heard it. Not from your mouth, though. Another foul ball. Saluki's. It is a breed of a dog. By the looks at it, you Googled it and looked up what a Saluki looked like, you'd say that's a high-dollar dog. It's not a mutt, I'll tell you that. Another throw over to first base. I had to Google that a couple years ago. First time we went down to Southwest Tennessee. Here's a ground ball, base hit. Just call him base hit Paul. I think he now has the team lead. 2-for-2 in this game now.
Now batting.
Christian Dunn steps to the plate. He's doubled.
Christian
stranded
Dunn
at third in the second inning. He was inches away from a home run. He has one on the year, but he was inches away from his second. He hit one off the top of the left field fence. Does not offer at that first pitch strike. Dunn came in hitting 211, had eight hits. Four of those were extra bases, three doubles and a home run. Now he has more extra base hits than he does singles. He's now looking at an 0-2 pitch from Peyton Charles out for his fourth inning of work. VolState surrendered four runs in the top of the fourth inning, trying to get some of that or all of it back. Charles missed badly on that 0-2 pitch. Only two players that I know of for Southwest that are already committed. Hayden Collins, the starting pitcher in game earlier today, heading to Eastern Kentucky. Pitch is fouled back. And Jeff Two from Canada. Pitcher on the Southwest staff is heading to Eastern Michigan. Pioneers have Caleb Pique headed to Lipscomb. Noah Eatman headed to Kaiser, and Brody Melton headed to Milligan. Anybody else is committed? I don't know about it. Two balls, two strikes to the sophomore catcher. Dunn looking to put some pop in here and swings and foul tips it into the glove for strike three. It's a big sweeping curveball there by Peyton Charles. Peyton with a P-E-Y-T-O-N. Up his fourth strikeout, first one since the second inning. Now Gage Hoover going to have to do it again with two outs. Actually did it with one out on a sacrifice fly last time. Sacrifice fly this time won't work. Almost sounded like he tipped it with his bat there, but did not go around as they checked with Daniel Rios, the base umpire. Hoover had a sacrifice fly into right center field. Catch was made by Stephen Hayden. Scored Connor Paul. Christian Dunn moved over to third base on the play, but Pioneers could not push Dunn across. Just off the end of the bat, that will go foul. Hoover fouled a bunch of balls in his last at-bat off to the right side. It's a little bit of an inside-out swing. Mr. Baseball Award winner last year out of Stewart's Creek High School. Had two Creekers playing in game one, and now Creeker here in game two of the doubleheader. VolState won game one yesterday, 12-2. Southwest 7-2 winner here. That ball's in the dirt. Gets by Charlie Smith. Caroms over to the VolState on deck circle. Everybody moves up 90 feet. Except me. I'm staying right here. Now two in scoring position for the freshman from Smyrna, Tennessee. 6'1", 205-pound. There's a base hit in the left field. They're going to score one, hold the runner at third. Hoover's going to go on to second base. A smart base running move as the throw in from Sammy Chapman. It's over the head of the cutoff man, and runners are going to be back at second and third. RBI single for Gage Hoover. He has both RBIs in the game.
Now batting number 21, Nathan Aguilar.
Second on the throw. Don't give Southwest an error on that. Although, probably technically it is. Lewis, who led off with a single, scores. Ground ball to short. Luck it up with it. Throws it in the dirt, but it's smothered by Evan Ash for out number three. Aguilar swinging at the first pitch. He has two ground outs, two short, and has ended the second and the fourth. Pioneers get one on three hits. Now we have five hits for the game. No errors. Two runners left on base. We are through four, 5-2. Southwest Tennessee leads. You're listening to the VolState Sports Network.
Cybercrimes take place online, and companies need more well-trained workers to stop it.
VolState is training me to help combat cybercrimes in the future.
We're training them for those type of jobs that are out there. VolState CIT programs prepare students to earn industry standard certifications within the IT industry.
I choose VolState because the future needs me now. My story could be your story.
A degree in criminal justice can help you find the exciting career that you've been looking for. As a member of law enforcement, as a crime scene investigator, a teacher in a classroom, a detective working on cases, a lawyer or judge, or nearly any job where you get to put the bad guys away. Learn more at volstate.edu.
Summit Concrete call to the bullpen for the Pioneers. Noah Eatman, 6'1", 205-pound sophomore from Parrish, Florida. He is headed to Kaiser University down in West Palm Beach, Florida. He's the son of Dave and Monique Eatman. Grandson of Papa in Englewood, Florida, and Gigi in Parrish, Florida. He is on in relief of Chip Harris, who goes four innings, gives up five hits, five runs that were earned, walked three, struck out five. Gave up the three-run home run to Sammy Chapman, which right now is the difference in the game. Eatman on for his 14th appearance of the year, 22 and a third innings. Has 19 strikeouts. This is his 11th appearance in relief. He will face 4, 5, and 6 in the Southwest Tennessee lineup. Charlie Smith leading off. He's 1 for 1. A single and a walk. First pitch, breaking pitch, misses outside. Goes two. Line drive out to right field. Cam Hodges is going to have to play that one on a hop. Charlie Smith, his second hit of the game.
Number 8, Hayden Collins.
Looks like he's more comfortable swinging it from that left side. Hayden Collins 0 for 2. He has flied out to left field twice. Breaking pitch. That's nice glove work by Aguilar on to second and around the horn for a dude that double play 5-4-3. Just what Dr. Eatman needed right there.
Now batting number 19,
Evan double play. Nice glove work by Nathan Aguilar down at third base. Struggled on in his first chance. Popped out to right field. This could be a quick inning for Noah Eatman. Cam Hodges makes the catch. Just throws the ball back into the infield to nobody. Let's get the second and the third out up there very quick inning. 2, 3, 4, 5 pitches for Noah Eatman right there after giving up the leadoff single to Charlie Smith. And Ball State right back in the dugout. See if they can square things up here with Southwest Tennessee. Do to them what was done to the Pioneers in game one. Ball State had that 2-0 lead. All they needed was 3 outs. But Southwest Tennessee scored 2 in the top of the 7th inning. Ball State had chances in the bottom of the 7th and the bottom of the 8th. But top of the 9th was all Southwest Tennessee in game one of this doubleheader. They scored 5 runs. Ended up going on for the victory. It's now the rubber game of the series. Ball State trying to get its first series win of the year. Peyton Charles back out for the 5th. Logan Molnar, Brady Knepper, and Stephen Bell are scheduled to come to the plate. Pioneers will be back here at home. Take on Lake Area Postgrad here at 1 o'clock on, I believe that is, let's see, Wednesday? It's the 16th. Don't have the date written up here. Gotta go to my trusty calendar. What will we do without smartphones? Actually, Tuesday. That's right. I'm possibly broadcasting a high school game on Wednesday for Pope John Paul, former coach John Rypel. As the JP or the Pope Prep, as they're called now, taking on, I believe, Brentwood Academy in that game. That is Pope Prep versus BA, Brentwood Academy, on Wednesday the 17th. But Lake Erie Academy coming in for Tuesday. First pitch swinging Logan Molnar. Surprise. It means something to me because there, in my 3 years of college baseball, I don't think I ever swung at the first pitch. I don't say that that's good. Just saying it's different. Some people go up there looking for that first strike, and if it's on the first pitch, they're after it. I never did that. Breaking pitch catches the inside corner as Molnar starts turning away from it, but he is right on the plate. Got hit by a pitch in the first inning. No chance of being hit with that one. Molnar's been plunked now 8 times, which is tied with Brady Knepper for the team lead. Brady with nowhere near as many at-bats as Molnar, swinging a miss on a tailing fastball.
Now batting number 3, Brady Knepper.
Molnar now 0-2. Fifth strike out of the game by Charles. Knepper 0-2, couple pop-outs. Charles delivers fastball up. And now down. Walter State defeated Roan State 2 games, 13-1 and 9-4. Called strike there. Columbia State over Cleveland State 4-3. And leading 7-3 in the bottom of the 6th. Fouled off to the right side, Sumner Regional Medical Center foul ball. Montlow State at Dyersburg State. Dyersburg won game 1, 6-3. Swing and a miss. Charles buries a breaking pitch at Knepper's knees.
Now batting number 22, Stephen Bell.
Hard to see that pitch not catching the inside corner, but it's got such a sharp break as it gets to the plate. It's up on your kneecap as you're swinging over the top of it. Stephen Bell's going to wear that one. That's a fastball that rode in on him. That's his fifth hit by pitch of the year.
Now batting number 30, Cannon Lewis.
Second hit batter of the game by Peyton Charles. Charles came in with 10 hit batters, now has 12 for the season. Tied with Zach Seward, who was the starting pitcher in yesterday's game. They've got three pitchers with 10 or more. I'm sorry, that is not correct. Peyton Charles is the other one. They have two pitchers with 10 or more. So a two-out base runner brings Cannon Lewis to the plate. He could inch the Pioneers closer with a big fly right here. Wind blowing out to dead center. Breaking pitch breaks right over the plate. Cannon Lewis's two home runs in Motlow, I believe both of them were to right center field down at Motlow. Not had a long ball since, as there's a lob throw over to first base. Definitely not a stolen base opportunity here. Now with a possible home run hitter. Instead of base hitter right here, Cannon Lewis picks up his second hit in his many at-bats, putting runners at first and second. Reached out and poked that one into left field.
Now batting number 35,
was up the middle.
Cam Hodges.
So Cam Hodges comes to the plate. Out of the dugout comes head coach Eric Schoenrock. Going to have a chat with Peyton Charles. Hodges is 0 for 2, looking for his first hit of the ball game. Had three hits at the Cumberland game that I was not at. Over at Cumberland a couple weeks ago. And when he's got opportunities, he's made the most of them. Let's see if he can make the most of this opportunity here. Gets a second crack at his walk-up song. Thanks to Braxton Alexander. See if he comes out of his shoes on this first pitch. Swing and a miss. Fastball outside. The outside part of the plate. He's got a five-game hitting streak going, Cam Hodges does. That is an easy ground ball down to Ash off the end of the bat, and that will end the inning. So he'll have to wait to see if he gets another plate appearance. Pioneers waste two base runners, no runs. One hit, no errors, two runners left on base. It's getting late early here, folks. Move to the sixth inning, two innings left on the schedule. Southwest Tennessee leads 5-2. You're listening to the VolState Sports Network.
Have you ever wondered what happens when you click buy it now? A whole series of transactions take place from the manufacturer to your front door.
That is logistics and supply chain management.
At VolState, we offer end-to-end supply chain courses.
Going into the future, our students need to understand these processes.
A lot of business is dependent upon getting a product on time.
Students here at VolState are able to leave here with that knowledge.
Because the supply chain
is counting on me.
Valley Cassidy Brick and Stone alumni spotlight for today's game. Cam Matting, former first baseman here at Ball State, now plying his trade at Freed Hardeman along with Game 1's alumni spotlight. Houston High, Cam Matting. I think he was here for 3 years in 2022, my first year of broadcasting. 309 hitter, had 5 home runs and 37 RBIs. That was good enough for third on the team in RBIs. Cam now having a very successful career down at Freed Hardeman in the NAIA. He doesn't have a brick either down here in the alumni brick patio. We got to get him on the hook to put a Cam Matting, years 21 and 22, at first base. He's another former Creeker, Stewart's Creek High School. Had a bunch of them here since I've been here. Brought to you by Alley Cassidy Brick and Stone as Connor Brinkley swings and misses. First pitch he sees from Noah Eatman on for his second inning of work. Brinkley's 1-for-2, scored a run. Again, if you have a second-year or third-year player who's not returning to VolState next year, you want to get them in the alumni brick patio, their name and years they played, positions they played. Love to get a brick installed in there. Let me know. Is that ball's grounded? That's going to sneak on through into right field for a base hit. As they said when I was swinging it like that, a seeing eye hit. But it looks like a
number 14,
screaming Mimi in the score sheet. Seventh hit of the ball game for Southwest Tennessee. Second hit of the day for Brinkley. Rager's got one of them. He's at the plate. Yeah. Pitch is yanked way outside. Wild pitch puts Brinkley on at second. Now in scoring position for Preston Rager, who's already got a couple RBIs on the day and a couple hits. So called strike. Send me an email, treesports@gmail.com, if you're interested in picking up a brick for your son or grandson, next door neighbor, whoever it might be. Swing and a miss. Nice action on that curveball. Count right, 1-2 strikes, according to the Toyota of Gallatin scoreboard in left center field. Run by Alex Qualls, medical redshirt right-hander out of Lipscomb Academy. Another one misses down. Noah Eatman, also one of the 10 full count 242 members. 5 pitchers, 5 position players. He is the only right-handed pitcher of the pitchers. That fastball is going to catch that outside corner. He's going to get Rager looking. He's down on strikes for the second time in this ball game. First strikeout for Noah Eatman.
Number 31, Ryan Welch.
Now, Ryan Welch, the number 9 hole hitter, steps in. 0-for-2. And if you even know somebody who played years ago, you can tell them about it, and they can send an email to me, and I'll give them the information. $100 for the brick, and I'll send you the sign-up form or the information sheet. You send your money and your sheet to Athletic Director Bobby Hudson. Fastball catches the inside corner. Eatman ahead. On Welch, 0-2, have several grandparents that have indicated they want to buy bricks. Sometimes There's a fight over it. I mean, it's nonviolent. Last year we had Jace Mizell, both sets of grandparents sent money in, and I think Bobby Hudson took whatever the first check was, deposited that one, held on the other one for 5 months or more. High chopper, Brady Knepper gloves and throws on to first base to retire Ryan Welch. It's a tough play right there.
Now batting number six.
On the play, Brinkley moves over to third. Now the leadoff batter, Stephen Hayden, steps in. He's 0 for 1, has walked twice and scored both times he's walked. Note to self, do not walk Stephen Hayden. Make him swing the bat. Swinging it pretty good, comes in hitting 300. Eatman misses with the first two breaking pitches. So if we have multiple grandparents, you can pay for somebody else on the team. I can make a suggestion. You can send it in and let Athletic Director Bobby Hudson make the suggestion on who it is. Or head coach Jim McGuire can, or you can tell them to pick an older alum. That's who I'd pick. Young goes 3 balls and a strike to the leadoff batter. And there he goes again. Draws his third walk of the game. First walk by Eatman today. Runners now on the corners for Sammy Chapman, who in this similar situation as last at-bat, hit his 7th home run of the year. On to the
up the bat, number 18,
top of
Sammy
the
Chapman
batting cage down in right field. Up 3 RBIs. He has 5 for the day. Runner starts to go. Chapman's going to get hit in the wallet. Bases are now loaded with Salukis. Chapman was hit by a pitch in the first inning, but was deemed to have swung the bat. Logan Luckett steps in with bases loaded and 2 out. A 3-hole hitter looks at a breaking pitch low and away. Eatman with what turned out to be a 1-2-3 inning in the 5th, his first inning. Gave up a leadoff single and then got a do-that double play off the bat of Hayden Collins. Got Evan Ash to fly out. There's a called strike. Run into some trouble here in the 6th. Give up a leadoff single. Struck out Rager and got Welch on a ground out, but a walk and a hit batter have loaded the bases. Pop down the right field line. Cam Hodges will give chase, but it will one hop into the Salukis bullpen as Creel Waddell throws another baseball out to Noah Eatman, who did all but dive to try to catch that errant throw. So error to the home plate umpire. Nobody moves up a base, though. 1-2 on my scoreboard. Now 2 balls and 2 strikes. And there, the Toyota of Gallatin scoreboard has 2s all across the top. Beautiful digital scoreboard if you've not been here. Pioneer Field. Right down the can, and Noah Eatman gets Logan Luckett looking with the L alliteration. Picks up his 2nd strikeout of the inning and leaves 3 stranded. No runs, 1 hit, no errors, 3 runners left on base. Pioneers got to get cracking here. They're down by 3. As Yogi Berra says, it gets late early here in these 7-inning ball games. Pioneers will send 6, 7, and 8 to the plate. See if Peyton Charles comes back out for the bottom of the 6th. You're listening to the VolState Sports Network.
Have you ever wondered what happens when you click buy it now? A whole series of transactions take place from the manufacturer to your front door.
That is logistics and supply chain management.
At VolState, we offer end-to-end supply chain courses.
Going into the future, our students need to understand these processes.
A lot of business is dependent upon getting a product on time.
Students here at VolState are able to leave here with that knowledge.
Because the supply chain
is counting on me.
We're all working in the cloud. But what really is the cloud? If you start pulling back the clouds themselves, you find out it's an infrastructure. Computer science is really computer engineering. Right now,
Middle Tennessee is quickly becoming a growing tech hub with several IT companies that are looking for skilled workers.
If you're pursuing the CIT program at Ball State, you're preparing yourself to fill those positions.
New pitcher on the mound for the Salukis, number 33, Mason Little. Right-hander out of Bartlett, Tennessee, 6'1", 180-pound freshman, on for his 12th appearance of the year, 10th in relief. He has a 6.05 ERA, has 3 saves, and he's coming in a save situation. They have 12 saves on the year, which didn't check to see, but I bet you that is tops in the league. You don't see that many saves typically. 19 in the third innings, giving up 17 hits, 16 runs, 13 earned. Walked 16, struck out 21. Giving up 2 long balls and plunked 4 batters. Peyton Charles goes 5 innings, gives up 6 hits, 2 runs. They were earned. Hit 2 batters, struck out 6. Did not walk a batter. He is in line for his 5th win of the year. Connor Paul, the hit machine, steps in. First pitch swinging, guess what he did? He dumps a base hit into right field. Kid is on fire. He's got 6 hits for the doubleheader. Christian Dunn steps to the plate. He's 1-for-2. Just misses inside. Dunn, 6 foot, 195 pound sophomore out of Collierville, Tennessee. So he's right there in the backyard of Southwest Tennessee. He's the son of Cordell and Baisha Dunn. Has a grandma in Tunica, Mississippi, and granddad and grandma in Greenville, Mississippi. Swing and a miss on a disappearing breaking pitch. Connor Paul's grandparents in Tulsa. Not trying to stir the pot, but I'm wondering, does his hitting prowess come from Jonathan's side or Ame Lee's side? So we have Mam in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and Pop-Pop and Graham also in Tulsa. Not sure where it all lies. But ever since he's been in the starting lineup, he has swung it well as Christian Dunn is down on strikes. Second strikeout of the game for Christian. First strikeout for Mason Little, who's on in relief of Peyton Charles. Gage Hoover, productive 2 at-bats. He's driven in both of the Pioneer runs, sacrifice fly in a second, and a single into left in the 4th. See if he can drive in a couple of the long ball. Breaking pitch slips out of the hand of Little. Just past 5 o'clock Central Time here in Middle Tennessee. A cut at a high fastball there comes up empty. So Gage Hoover was not checking his portfolio. He also was not looking at mortgage rates, he told me. He was checking the Masters leaderboard in between games, he said. Two balls and a strike to the freshman outfielder, 2023 Mr. Baseball from Stewart's Creek High School. Also the Stewart's Creek High School Male Athlete of the Year. Mason Little asking home plate umpire if that pitch was up. Didn't see Mr. Wildell's answer, but that's ball four. Gage Hoover will reach. Nathan Aguilar gets another at-bat. He's grounded out twice to the shortstop. Swung at the first pitch, I know, in his last at-bat. I want to say he may have saw a few pitches in his first at-bat in the second. Two on, one out. Does not swing at that breaking pitch. Called a strike. Aguilar is out of Rockvale High School in Murfreesboro, Tennessee. Son of Renario and Ivania Aguilar. Brother to Henry and Jocelyn. 5'8", 200-pound freshman. He can hit the ball pretty well, too. Could drive it out of the park if he gets the right pitch. And that's not it. It is target season here. Eric Schoenrock comes out to get the baseball, and he does not look happy. Now the tying run is on at first base. Brings up the top of the order. It's a right-hander getting loose in the bullpen. Connor Paul led off with a single to right. After a Christian Dunn strikeout, a walk to Gage Hoover, and now a plunking of Nathan Aguilar loads the bases. Pioneers looking to return the favor as Southwest Tennessee had a come-from-behind victory in Game 1 of the doubleheader, and Ball State looking to do the same thing. Schoenrock done with his meeting. Conversation with Mason Little.
Number one, Logan Molnar.
Time for big spark from Logan Molnar. He's got one hit in 8 plate appearances on the day. Did not get a hit in yesterday's ball game. There's a fastball that misses down. Mason Little. Can't be happy with that call right there. He might have thought he had something at the knees. Molnar looks at a breaking pitch. It's like a pretty good slider right there. Molnar, one home run, 11 RBIs. Just missed off the outside corner. I've seen that pitch called a strike today. Creel Waddell, home plate umpire, explaining as to where that was. Gives the international sign of it's outside. 2-1 pitch. That pitch is going to catch the corner. Not sure what that was. It was something off speed. But not a, didn't look like a curveball, but maybe a changeup. It goes 2-2. One out, and the bases are juiced. On deck, Brady Knepper. I'm telling you, Mason Little has been wearing out that outside corner. We have a full count ministry's full count. If I were Logan Molnar, I wouldn't take that pitch again. He can go opposite way. They're throwing him outside. They do, and he draws the RBI walk. Bases stay loaded, and that will end the afternoon for Mason Little, who goes a third of the inning. And we will get a new pitcher. Mason Little won't get the save today. We'll take a break, tell you about the new pitcher. We return on the VolState Sports Network.
Have you ever wondered what happens when you click buy it now? A whole series of transactions take place from the manufacturer to your front door.
That is logistics and supply chain management.
At VolState, we offer end-to-end supply chain courses.
Going into the future, our students need to understand these processes.
A lot of business is dependent upon getting a product on time.
Students here at VolState are able to leave here with that knowledge.
Because the supply chain
is counting on me.
We're all working in the cloud. But what really is the cloud? If you start pulling back the clouds themselves, you find out it's an infrastructure. Computer science is really computer engineering. Right now,
Middle Tennessee is quickly becoming a growing tech hub with several IT companies that are looking for skilled workers.
If you're pursuing the CIT program at Ball State, you're preparing yourself to fill those positions.
New pitcher on for the Salukis is Braden Stewart, right-hander out of Warsaw, Kentucky. Was the starting first baseman in game one of the series yesterday, and he left the game injured as he and Drew Plummer collided at first base. And it looked like it bent back his left wrist, but looks like he's okay. He's moving that glove around just fine, and he will come on in relief of Mason Little, who goes a third of an inning, gives one hit, and so far one run. But the runners on base now are his responsibility. Walked two, struck out one, and hit a batter. Braden Stewart will now come on in a save situation. Or I would assume if he could get out of this inning with the lead, Coach Eric Schoenrock would allow him to continue on in the seventh. Ball State trying to at least tie or take the lead here in the bottom of the sixth. Stewart's on for his 13th appearance of the year, all in relief, a 4.82 ERA. In 18 and two-thirds innings, he's got 30 punch-outs and only walked eight batters. Giving up nine hits, but 11 runs, 10 are earned, so looks like you're going to have to earn it on Braden Stewart. Brady Knepper in a battle of the Braids, Braden and Brady. Knepper fouls off the first pitch he sees. That was a jam shot. Knepper's 0 for 3, a couple pop outs and a strikeout. Those middle infielders at double play depth. There's a fastball poured in there for a called strike. Knepper down in the count. 0-2. Looking for a big hit from Brady Knepper. There's a little pace to that fastball right there. Stewart trying to get that high strike on the outside corner. 1-2 pitch to Knepper. That sails over the head of Brady. That's always fun to see. Zach Zimmerle, hopefully he's standing right. No, is that Thrain? That is fisted. That's going to be infield fly rule, and catch is made at second base for out number two. Now number 22, Stephen Bell. Brady Knepper is now popped out to everybody in the infield except the third baseman. Stephen Bell stands in on the left side. He's looking for his first hit of the game. Hits are even on the scoreboard, but the runs are not. There's a strike at the knees in the inside corner. Nathan Aguilar getting a huge lead out there at second base. He'll score easily on a base hit. If he gets out sliced off to the left side. Bell's now down in the count 0-2. But he is fine with a pitch to slide into that 5.5 hole between short and third. Braden Stewart looks like he's been doing nothing but throwing fastballs. Looks at the runner at third. Sails one. Here comes Hoover. And the tag applied late. Gage Hoover scores on the wild pitch. And everybody moves up 90 feet. Ball State now down by one. Tying run at third. Go-ahead run at second base. And another pitch sailed high and away. Down goes two balls and two strikes. Two outs, two on. Two in the inning. Connor Paul scored and Gage Hoover in a swing and a foul tip into the glove. And down goes Bell. And the Pioneers leave the tying and go-ahead runs stranded. Score two. Those runs are charged to Mason Little. There was one hit. No errors. Two runners left on base. We are headed to the seventh. Southwest Tennessee with the one-run lead now. Mason Little ends up going a third of an inning, giving up one hit and two runs, which were earned. Walk two, struck out one, hit a batter. Braden Stewart comes on. At this point, has the hold. They don't count that stat in college baseball, but we have a Summit Concrete call to the bullpen for the Pioneers. Freshman Cooper Anderson on for Ball State, the third pitcher on, 6 foot, 175-pound freshman. He's from Ravenwood High School, the son of David Anderson and Christina Sargent. There's a Grandpa Art, a Papa and a Nana, and a Grandma somewhere in the United States. I don't have the towns for those various grandparents, but Cooper Anderson on in relief of Noah Eatman. Anderson appearing in his 10th game. 14 and two-thirds innings, giving up 11 hits, 16 runs. They were earned, 15 walks, 23 strikeouts. He's going to need to limit the walks here to endear himself to the coaching staff. Wearing the number 37, Eatman ends up going two innings, giving up two hits, no runs. Walked one, struck out two, and hit a batter. First pitch delivered by Anderson in there for a called strike. Brad Fussell has answered. That one is fouled back from Tulsa. John Paul's side of the family is where all those hits are coming from for Connor Paul. Splitter misses outside. Cooper Anderson wearing the number worn for 2 years as he gets the swing and throw is caught. And then the acrobatic move by Connor Paul to rock back and put his foot on first base as the throw was off target by Christian Dunn. But the 2-3 put out was completed on the strikeout. Hayden Collins will step in with one out and nobody on. breaking pitch, missed somewhere. I believe Cooper's grandparents or someone said is here. So I'm talking to some folks between games. Collins 0 for 3, fouls that one off. Brad, thanks for the informative email to treesports@gmail.com. Love interacting with those that are listening in and watching. Anderson thought he might have had him one there, but the count goes 2 balls and 2 strikes. Ground ball to short. Molnar hadn't been too busy. Nice, smooth throw over to Connor Paul. We're out number two.
Now that in
State
number
needs
19,
another out and then come into the bottom of the seventh, score a couple runs, and steal one back from Southwest Tennessee. Cam Matting, our alumni spotlight, hitting 252 down at Freed Hardeman this year. Evan Ash did a pitch pretty close right there. Matting 6 home runs and 25 RBIs. Believe this is his senior year for the Lions. Fine young man. Sure enjoyed being around him for the 1 year. We had 5 creakers that year. 3-0 count to Evan Ash, who's 0 for 3. He's flown out to each of the 3 outfielders today. Squares the bunt. Pulls the bat back for a called strike. Fly out to all 3 outfielders, and you want to get on base any way you can. 3-1 pitch popped up. This won't go to an outfielder. Looks like Logan Molnar. No, it will. Logan Molnar was looking like he was going to take that one. He got out there a little farther. Stephen Bell's going to get Evan Ash for 2 putouts today. A 1-2-3 inning. Terrific job by Cooper Anderson. Keep his team in it, and we will go to the bottom of the seventh. Ball State needs 1 to tie, 2 to win, and walk it off again as they did in yesterday's game, albeit a 10-run mercy rule game. The game not in doubt when they walked it off. Today's game is in doubt. Ball State will be at their 4, 5, and 6 batters in the lineup. We'll see who Coach McGuire sends out. As I see Cannon Lewis, the DH, looks like he's ready to hit. Braden Stewart back out on the mound to try to get the save and win the game for Peyton Charles. Again, we want to thank all of our sponsors and supporters. Outfield sign holders are a beautiful scoreboard out there provided by Toyota of Gallatin. Eric Carr, the general manager, and Jake Thompson, general sales manager. I was hoping here before the end of the year to have the commercials that we can play in addition to the 2 sets that we've been playing for Toyota of Gallatin there on Facebook for feature Jim McGuire, head baseball coach, and Johnny Lynn, the head men's basketball coach, that are stars in their own habitats, one on the baseball field, one in the Richard Moore Gymnasium. If you haven't seen those, you can go and find those on Facebook. They're kind of fun, if in fact you want to look at a commercial, but kind of funny. Cannon Lewis swings at the first pitch, rides in on him, fastball. That one catches a little bit of the left forearm of Charlie Smith, the catcher. Lewis is 2 for 3. He's got a couple singles in his last 2 plate appearances. He could tie it up with 1 swing of the bat. Oh, he had a pitch to hit right there, just missed it. move past the two-hour mark of this ball game. Breaking pitch. I haven't been keeping close eye on the pitches that Stewart throws. That may have been the first breaking pitch he's thrown. Maybe back to the fastball here, and he is not, and I have no idea where that pitch missed. But it is a ball somewhere, and the count goes 2 balls and 2 strikes. I thought Cannon Lewis was going to be heading back to the dugout. 2-2 count. Pops that one up. That'll get out of play. Great job by Noah Ward today, our ball boy. Bringing baseballs out to Creel Waddell, our home plate umpire. Breaking pitch misses up. With a full count, Ministries full count. Cam Hodges on deck. Looks like the Lady Pioneers are finished up across the way. Fly ball out to center field. Stephen Hayden moves over to his right. Almost in the dead center field to make the catch for out number one.
Now batting number 35,
Cam Hodges steps to the plate. He's got a chance to make history for himself right here. He can pick up his first collegiate home run and tie this game up. Instead, he's going to get a hit by a pitch. Fourth hit batter for Ball State in this game.
Nate
Charles had 2.
Hunter Paul.
Hit batters Mason Little had 1. And now Braden Stewart is pinch running for Cam Hodges as Drew Plummer is the potential tying run. And the hit factory, Connor Paul, the bear. See if he swings. He does not swing at the first pitch. They are playing him to pull. That is not scouting report, although he has pulled his fastballs. And then they throw a pitch outside. That's not playing to your defensive positioning there. He does have 2 base hits to right field, but he loves going the opposite way. He is trying to do it right there, but comes up empty. Now down 0-2. Six for 7 on the doubleheader. And now everybody wearing Pioneer gear rooting for Connor Paul to get a base hit. He grounds one to the right side, so the positioning worked here. Tying run now at second base.
Now
with 2 outs, now Christian Dunn steps to the plate. Don't have to have a hit to score the run. Braden Stewart has shown a little bit of wildness here and has wild pitched a run in already. A couple wild pitches and this game's tied, and there was almost one right there. Charlie Smith had to get up on his high horse. Track that one down. Charlie Smith, a bit height challenged. I think he's about 5'10". Stewart just rearing back and throwing fastballs here. I don't even know why he's looking at his wrist. I wouldn't throw anything but a fastball right here. Dunn 1 for 3. So if you can hit it, you can hit it. But this kid looks like he can throw it. That's a good pitch right there. Fastball and the Pioneers down to their last strike. Count 1 ball, 2 strikes. Braxton Alexander says he'd throw a curveball right here. I would absolutely not. Fastball. Here it is. See if you can hit it. Christian Dunn takes a hack. Comes up empty and Salukis come back and get the series win. Second strikeout of the game for Braden Stewart. He picks up the save. Southwest Tennessee wins this one 5-4. Winning pitcher is Peyton Charles. He moves to, I believe that's 5-4. 5-4 it is. And Chip Harris will take the loss. He falls to 2-3. Save to Braden Stewart. Picks up his third save of the year. Pioneers fall to 4-16 in conference play. Southwest Tennessee moves to 9-12 in conference. 5 runs, 7 hits, no errors for Southwest Tennessee. And unofficial statistics, 4 runs, 7 hits, 1 error for VolState. Cooper Anderson did come in and throw an inning of perfect relief. No hits, did pick up a strikeout. So good outing for Cooper Anderson. Pioneers, who are looking at a series win, up 2-0 going into the last inning in game one. Ended up seeing Southwest Tennessee score 2 in the top of the 7th and then 5 in the top of the 9th in game one of the doubleheader. And then hold on for a 5-4 victory over the Pioneers in game two of the doubleheader. VolState back in action next Tuesday right here at Pioneer Field against the Lake Area Academy postgrad team. April 16th, we'll carry it right here on the VolState Sports Network. The player of the game, we go with Peyton Charles, the starting pitcher for Southwest Tennessee. Go with him and Sammy Chapman, who had the big 3-run home run that gave them the margin of victory as co-Toyota of Gallatin players of the game, both for Southwest Tennessee. And our Full Count Ministries verses of game two found in the 10th chapter of Hebrews. Verses 24 and 25, I call them the lettuce, but lettuce verses. Starts in 24. There's a lot of lettuces in this chapter. Let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Find that in Hebrews chapter 10, verses 24 and 25. Those are the Full Count Ministries verses of Game 2. I'd like to thank Full Count Ministries for their broadcast equipment that we use here on the VolState Sports Network. Braden Stewart goes an inning and two-thirds, does not give up a hit or a run, does hit a batter, and strikes out two, including Christian Dunn, to end the ball game. He picks up his third save of the year. In a game that took 2 hours and 6 minutes to complete under a beautiful spring sky with lots of sunshine here, 76 degrees at game time. For Athletic Director Bobby Hudson and Head Coach Jim McGuire, this is Tim Reese saying so long. Thank you again for joining me for today's doubleheader. God bless you. We'll talk to you again soon on the VolState Sports Network.